name's Cliff Marriott. I'm a managing director in our TMT investment banking business. I'm very happy to welcome Boyan Slat here, who's the CEO and founder of the Ocean Cleanup. Just to give some statistics, more than 8 million tons of plastic is dumped into our oceans every year, and the problem continues to grow. Over the next 8 years, we're going to create, as humans, more plastic than was created in the whole 20th century. So the problem is very massive. We're going to talk a little bit about the problem. We're going to talk about what Boyan and his team are doing to solve that problem, and a little bit of how he came into this. So why you chose to focus on this as your cause, and what was the background to your decision?
Yeah. I think it was a bit of an accident, really. I've always been fascinated by technology, so I've been making things since I was 2 years old, I think. So I was really looking for something to sort of useful to create, to build. I found that when I was 16 years old, I was scuba diving in Greece, and I looked around me and I realized I saw more plastic bags than fish. And I wondered, why can't we just clean this up? This area, this Great Pacific Garbage Patch between Hawaii and California, where most of the plastic accumulates. It's about three times the size of France. So you can imagine if you were to go out with boats and nets, which is what people had been proposing before. It would take quite a while. It would take around 80,000 years, approximately. So then at some point in time, I thought, well, coastlines are actually very effective ways of capturing plastic. If you go to the beach, you see a lot of plastic. It's sort of out of the ocean, stays out of the ocean. So that's good. But the thing is that those big ocean garbage patches, there are five of them in the world, they're so far away from land that there's really no landmass that can intercept the plastic. So then at some point in time, we wondered, well, why don't you go? Why would you go after the plastic if the plastic can also come to you? So what we proposed was to really deploy a fleet of artificial coastlines there where there are no coastlines. So basically using the natural ocean currents in our advantage by deploying these very long U-shaped floating barriers that would first concentrate the plastic before we would take it out. And then, yeah, models showed that with a fleet of 60 of those cleanup systems, we should be able to clean up half this Great Pacific Garbage Patch every 5 years.
Can you go into a little bit more on how the tech works in terms of how, how do you place or how do you put the U-shaped machines in the right place so that they capture the garbage and...
Sure. Yeah, so the way it works, if you were to just deploy a U-shaped barrier in the ocean just like that, it wouldn't work because it would simply bob around at the same speed as the plastic and it would never catch the plastic, so that wouldn't be very useful. The key is that you need some kind of difference in speed between the plastic and the system. And the way we figured we could do that is that if you look at the vertical distribution of the speed of the current in the ocean, specifically in this area, at the surface, the water is moving really quite rapidly, while if you only go a few hundred meters deeper, the water is already virtually stagnant. The trick we came up with is that we suspend sort of a sea anchor, a drogue, in this deeper water layer, which creates enough drag to slow down the system at the surface just enough so that the system actually moves slower than the plastic. And that way, the plastic is able to accumulate along that that barrier. And then we wondered, well, where do these systems go to if we were to deploy them? We don't want them to end up in Alaska or California or whatever. So then we did some modeling, and then it turned out that these systems, because they are driven by the same forces that propel the plastic, so the waves, the winds, and the currents, they kind of automatically drift towards those areas where most plastic can be found. So that way, really just, again, using the natural forces in our advantage, the systems actually stay in those garbage patches and actually go to where most plastic is.
Perfect. Can you, maybe stepping back, just contextualize the problem? So how much garbage is there? What are the impacts? Or how much plastic is there? What are the impacts on the environment, on marine mammals, other species, and on humans.
Yeah. But when you look at the impacts, are really three areas why it's not good to have plastic in the ocean. First, the obvious one is the impact to ecosystems. So there are currently around 800 species threatened with extinction directly because of this this plastic pollution. So think about entanglement, marine life getting stuck in nets or consuming the plastic. Leading to the second problem, which is that chemicals that are attached to the plastic through the plastic actually end up in the food chain, which is a food chain that includes us humans as well. So by consuming fish, actually the chemicals associated with that plastic can end up in our bodies too, which is not a very good thing. And then thirdly, there's the economic impact. The UN estimates that plastic in the ocean is currently already costing $13 billion a year. So it's pretty, we're pretty sure that it's cheaper to clean up than to leave in the ocean.
How do you answer the question that people may have that would say, why don't you focus the efforts on preventing plastic going in the ocean rather than clean up the existing plastic? And then I guess maybe a second question, if you are successful, which I hope you are, by collecting, what's in the ocean now, how do we keep collecting it? Will your system continue to work over time?
Yeah. Well, I think we really need to do both. The problem consists out of two parts. On one side, you have the legacy of the 50, 60 years of damage that has already been done and is still floating out there. And so what we see is, actually with our expeditions, we found plastic dating back to the 70s, still in recognizable shapes. So it's really clear that sort of once it's accumulated in those patches, it's there to stay. And it also becomes more harmful over time. So because it breaks down into these smaller and smaller pieces, the so-called microplastics, and the smaller the pieces get, the easier it becomes for them to end up in the food chain. So it's definitely, if you want to clean it up, you better do it sooner rather than later. So you have on one side you have the legacy problem, and on the other side you have the sort of the future problem of all the new plastic that will still be added. So I think on one side we need to clean up what's already out there. And on the other hand, we also need to prevent it from reaching the oceans. And I think on the legacy side, there's really just one way to do that, is sort of to develop these technologies and go out there. On the prevention side, of course, there is a multitude of things that can be done. Legislation will be part of it. The Ocean Clean Brazil is really a technology company. So I think if we will ever have a contribution on that side of the equation, we would probably be looking at systems that could be intercepting plastic, for example, near river mouths or near the coast. Before it would reach the oceans, but
is that how most of the plastic gets there? Is it through rivers?
Yes.
Or is it,
Actually, we did we published a study in Nature last year, and that shows that really the vast majority of the plastic is entering the oceans through rivers, and then we're talking about roughly 2 million tons of plastic. So it's the number one source of plastic.
And when you, and I agree, I think we need to do both. We need to collect it and then also prevent. But when you thought about solving this problem, did you evaluate other forms of technology to go after it? How did you resolve around doing it with the technology that you are adopting?
Yeah. If you look at the earliest videos that we did back in 2013 when we were founded, and compare the concept that we presented there versus the system that we're actually building right now, it's sort of there's almost no comparison. Sure, the basic principles of using nature in our advantage and the whole passive nature, sure, that's still there. But all the rest, all the details have been completely different, which has been, I think, for me as an inventor, maybe the number one challenge, because of course, to get something done and to mobilize people to help you, it's important to have a very strong vision and to communicate that vision and to really sort of paint a picture in people's minds of this is what we're going to build together. But at the same time, to actually be successful and to actually go and do something, you need to be extremely flexible and accept that sort of the picture that you painted can look completely different, and that it really doesn't matter what's going to be done as long as it happens. So that I think that has been quite a learning curve.
What were the challenges that you, in addition to the changing of the technology, what are the other challenges that you encountered over the last number of years in trying to get this to action?
The way we have kind of approached a project is sort of a cycle we went through. Basically, first getting results, then the next step of the cycle would be communicating those results, and then the third part of the cycle would be then sort of banking on those on that communication, raising either funding or recruiting people, et cetera, and then using those resources to then get to the next milestone, et cetera. So it's sort of this accelerating spiral staircase. Sort of the first round was a 90K crowdfunding campaign. The second one was a 2.2 million crowdfunding campaign. And now we've raised something like 40 million, and now we're really in the execution part of the cycle. So now really it's just about getting that first system working. So we locked the design last year. Basically all the parts have been produced right now and are sort of arriving in California right now, where we have rented an abandoned naval base adjacent to San Francisco, which is basically the only area with enough space in the whole San Francisco Bay Area. Because the system is really quite big. It's about 2,000 feet in length. And then we hope to launch it, sort of a trial run late May, and then the real deal by July. In terms of main challenges, it's really just getting it to work. On one side, how to make it as efficient as possible, and on the other hand, how to make sure that it doesn't break in big hurricanes. So what has really been important in that development process has been the sort of the iterative principles. So instead of, you know, engineers can basically spend years behind a computer and still not be ready, right? So that has been really important to set fixed deadlines and say, well, once we're on that date, even if it's not done, we're just going to build something and we're going to test it and really get that feedback from the real world. So for example, the first prototype that we did back in 2016, I think after 4 weeks, it was, you know, really blown into a billion pieces. Not a billion, okay, a few pieces, and we're still able to recover that, but that was, it didn't really look that pretty. But it was good learning, I would say.
What did you change as a result of that?
Yeah, so one of the
not
things
to get
there,
too technical, but okay. I'm interested.
So one of the problems that we had there was that we first relied on inflatable air chambers to keep the thing afloat, but the things were just leaking after a few weeks. So then we kind of changed that to sort of a solid pipe as a flotation device. So those are the kind of things that you'll never be able to model on a computer, and you're only really be able to find out in real life. So it's so really testing. We've probably done a few hundred scale model tests and dozens of prototypes in real life. So hopefully that has been enough to now actually get to a system that works this summer.
So you, when we asked you about challenges, you didn't mention team, but you've gathered a world-class team to help you do this. How did you motivate that team? Where did you find people? How did you kind of pull that team together? Obviously, another challenge that some of the entrepreneurs in the room are thinking about.
Yeah, I think we're quite fortunate in that we get a lot of people approaching us and being interested in working for us. Right now, we employ around 75 people. And especially, I think 1 year ago, we were at 30. So we had quite a rapid ramp up there. For me, always the most important thing is that there are two things that I always look for. It's sort of the sort of inherent curiosity of people and sort of people never being able to be satisfied. Because if you would, you'd probably go home and stop thinking about your work. And Just like with anything, I think it's the more computational hours you can put in something, the more results you would get. So so I kind of want people that are super obsessed about solving these problems, so that they basically are also thinking about this outside of working hours. And in general, just people that are sort of nice to work with. It's a small office, and you kind of want to spend it with nice people, I think.
That's great. I really want to thank you for coming here and helping us close DTS. I also want to thank you, even more importantly, for dedicating your life to this cause, which I think we can all agree is really important. And so thank you for both of those things, especially the second.
Thank you.